everybody, welcome to another talk with Andy and Randy. I'm Andy.
And I'm Randy, and we're glad you're with us today. Andrew, we're in between two pretty big days on the calendar.
Yeah, Mother's Day and Father's Day, those are pretty big days.
They are big days, but they're not what I was talking about.
Okay, well, people love long weekends, so maybe you're thinking Victoria Day and Canada Day. Those are both holidays too.
Those are real big days, you're right. But I was thinking more of the Christian calendar, which lays out the days for Christians to commemorate or celebrate, like Christmas and Easter.
Oh, okay, I think I see where you're going with this. Last week we were talking about Ascension Day, the day when Jesus was taken up to heaven and the angels told the disciples that Jesus was going to come back in the same way he left.
That's right, Jesus is coming again.
So then the second day would be this Sunday, Pentecost Sunday.
Absolutely, you got them both.
But today is the no man's land in between. What do we celebrate in this space?
Well, I can think of a couple of things. They come from Acts chapter 1.
Okay, well, in Acts 1 verse 9, we read about Jesus ascending or being taken up to heaven, and then in Acts 2, it's the story of Pentecost.
So why don't we read some verses in between there, starting with Acts 1:12, and see what comes up.
Okay, Acts 1 verse 12. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the hill called the Mount of Olives, a Sabbath day's walk from the city. When they arrived, they went upstairs to the room where they were staying. They, being the 11 disciples, all joined together constantly in prayer, along with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers.
Okay, let's pause there for a minute. Andrew, you've been to prayer meetings, right?
Yeah, I've been to quite a few. I've been to many that you've led, and I've led a couple myself.
Yeah, and how long do meetings typically go?
Well, a couple hours, but about an hour to an hour and a half would typically be the prayer portion of the meeting.
Yeah, and I've been to some prayer meetings where it's more talking than praying, and an hour meeting and 10 minutes of praying. But here it says they were praying constantly. You don't think that's literal, do you?
Well, I suspect they did pray a lot and that they were doing it together, but I'm fairly sure that over this 10-day period, they also talked about things that were going on and they discussed the things that Jesus had said, and they likely ate together too.
That sounds like what I think too. I was really impressed this week by that phrase, they all joined together constantly in prayer. Not taking it literally, but really impressed that this was a huge priority for them, for all of them. They prayed about anything and everything. Whenever something came up in conversation, it seems like they were saying, hey, you know what, we should pray about that too.
You know what, Randy, that reminds me of one of our prayer warriors here at Roseville Church. I've heard David Shoemaker on many occasions say he never tells someone he's going to pray for them without stopping to do it right there and then with them present, if at all possible. Mm-hmm. Also, when we could gather together, if Dave sensed that someone had a need, he would ask if they wanted prayer, and then he would gather a few people together and pray for them right there and then.
Yeah, I've seen him do that. We should all be quicker to do that, to pray with people on the spot, whether there's somebody that can join with us or just the two of us. It's not something you have to do in a big public way, be loud about it or obnoxious. Don't make a scene, but just quietly between the two of you, say a prayer. Just a few words can bring comfort and minister to their spirit.
And even on the phone or a video chat, when a need or a problem surfaces, it's often good to pause whatever is going on in the conversation and say a prayer right away. Then you can get back to the other parts of your conversation. Too often things are forgotten if left until later. So why not pray when the Spirit moves you or puts a need or a burden in front of you?
Mm-hmm. In Ephesians chapter 6, the Apostle Paul talks about there being a spiritual warfare, that Satan's trying to tear down everything good and godly, and he says, pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, the spiritual warfare, be alert and always keep on praying for all of the Lord's people.
The fact that we're involved in a spiritual war, that's a big part of why we pray, isn't it? If there were no opposition to good and to God and to God's people, there wouldn't be nearly the same need to pray about everything.
But we are in a battle, and Satan is out to frustrate God's plans and any plans we have for good or for God. It even talks in the book of Daniel about there being battles going on between angels and demons in the heavenly realm. The enemies come to steal and kill and destroy, Jesus said.
And in James 4:7, we read, submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil and he'll flee from you. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you.
And how do we draw near to God? A primary pathway is through prayer. Also worship, meditation on God's word, journaling, listening in prayer, Just spending time in his presence.
Randy, in John 15, Jesus says that apart from me, you can do nothing. I remember Pastor Ray Dirksen telling us that anything we don't pray about is something we think we can handle or deal with on our own, and we don't need help with it.
Yeah, that was a powerful message Pastor Ray delivered that day, and this line is the heart of the message. Are we independent, self-reliant, or are we Christ-dependent and God-reliant? If we're fully relying on God, then we'll really need to pray about just about everything. But if we're self-reliant, then we'll find we're not praying about much of anything at all.
They don't have to be long or drawn-out prayers, do they? They can be short.
They can. They just whisper a prayer in the morning is a song I learned as a kid. And that's all it takes, a quick prayer from our mind or heart in a situation or before a conversation, and the Lord hears it.
You know, that reminds me of the disciples in the Garden of Gethsemane with Jesus. When Jesus asked them to pray for him, they kept falling asleep. And Jesus said, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Now, after Jesus has gone into heaven, they've suddenly turned into prayer warriors. What do you think changed?
It's hard to know for sure, but I think it's linked to what you just said, that Jesus had gone up to heaven. The disciples were kind of lost without him, maybe felt a bit alone. And I think their level of desperation had gone through the roof. I know in my life, when I feel more desperate about a situation, I pray more earnestly. And they were also, though, told to stay in Jerusalem until the Father sent the Holy Spirit upon them with power so they could be witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, and to the uttermost parts of the planet.
Wow. You know that makes a light come on for me. Their situation, it was similar to ours. We're being held back by the commands of our government and these COVID restrictions. Mm-hmm. We aren't able to gather the same or reach out the same or do what we otherwise might be doing until things are opened up again. And the disciples, they're being held back by the command of Jesus. They're stuck in Jerusalem, but they commit themselves to prayer. It becomes their go-to activity. Maybe the Spirit is calling us to do more praying during this time when we aren't able to do many of the other things we normally would, to prepare ourselves for a fresh outpouring of God's Spirit upon us.
I like that. To commit ourselves to prayer, to seek for an outpouring from God's Spirit. The disciples in Jerusalem, they stayed there. They didn't try to run ahead of God. They had one job to do. It was to wait until the Holy Spirit came on them. And they prayed incessantly while they were waiting. I'm encouraged by the good turnouts we've had for our Sunday night prayer gatherings. We do share some about our lives and fellowship, but the primary purpose we have in coming together every week since this started is to pray for one another, for our church, and for our community and world.
Prayer is vital for each of us, for maintaining our connection to Christ and to one another, and to make a significant impact in the world for God's glory.
Hey, if you haven't joined us for one of our Sunday night prayer gatherings, you can ask for a link, and we'll be happy to send you an invitation to join in.
And you can find our contact information at roseville.ub.ca. That's roseville.ub.ca.
Andrew, next part of the passage, we see something that I'm sure they were praying about fervently, which was finding a replacement for Judas, who had betrayed Jesus and hung himself.
Yeah, verse 23 tells us that they nominated two men, Joseph called Barsabbas, who was also known as Justice, and Matthias.
In verse 21, Peter says, it's necessary to choose one of the men who've been with us the whole time the Lord Jesus was living among us, beginning from John's baptism to the time when Jesus was taken up from us. For one of these must become a witness with us of his resurrection.
There's a lot of folks that may not realize that there were other people besides the 12 disciples who traveled with Jesus, and they were with him from his baptism until his ascension.
Yeah, we don't normally talk about or think about that, and frankly, it had slipped my mind. But it's clear here that those were the qualifications being sought for Judas's replacement. They wanted someone who could be a witness of Jesus' life and teaching and miracles, but they specified becoming a witness of his resurrection.
I think that's something that the Lord wants for each of us, to be a witness to what he has done in us and for us and through us. We don't have to share our whole story out all at once. We can talk about how Jesus helps us overcome our apathy or control or our anger or our appetite for unhealthy things.
Or we can share with someone how Jesus makes a difference in our parenting or our marriage or our attitude and approach to work or conflict or any number of things.
Witnesses, just before Jesus was taken to heaven, he said the Holy Spirit would empower his followers to be his witnesses, beginning with where they were. They would share the good news of God's love and Jesus' sacrifice and salvation, his forgiveness and friendship everywhere they went until it reached the entire world.
There's one other point at the end of this passage that caught my attention. Verse 24 says, they prayed, Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which of these two you have chosen to take over this apostolic ministry, which Judas left to go where he belongs. Then they cast lots, and the lot fell to Matthias, so he was added to the 11 apostles.
Yeah, that stands out to me too. We've been talking a lot about listening to or hearing God, and that the primary way God speaks is through his word. Here, the disciples or the apostles are fully trusting God to guide the roll of the dice in order to reveal his will in deciding between Joseph, Barsabbas, and Matthias.
God is not limited in how he can communicate with us. They did their due diligence first and set the qualifications and narrowed the field to just these two deserving men. But when they were unable to differentiate on their own, they prayed and trusted God to show them in this unorthodox way, and God came through.
Just a word of caution here. We're not suggesting you just roll dice to decide on investments or making major decisions for your life. Mm-hmm. Weigh the pros and cons. Prayerfully consider all the information available, like the disciples did. But do believe that God can and will show you the way to go if you ask for wisdom and guidance.
He said he would do that. Having a relationship with Jesus enables all of us to experience the leading of the Lord in our lives. If you haven't developed a spiritual ear to recognize the promptings of the inner voice of the Holy Spirit, we'd love to help you and coach you in that.
So we need a deep commitment to personal and corporate prayer. And we need to grow in our relationship with Jesus, learning to discern and follow his leading for our lives.
We do. We need to grow in those and probably a lot of other areas too. Hey, let's pray together. Father in heaven, thank you for these words in scripture that remind us of how important prayer is in our relationship with you and to make an impact in this world for you. Lord, help us to keep learning and to keep growing, to have a greater desire to spend time with you and grow our relationship with you. Lord, many out there might need some kind of guidance or wisdom right now in their lives, and we pray that by your Spirit, you would give them what they need to find their way to follow you faithfully. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thanks again for joining us today.
God bless.